Hello, everyone. I am Lynn Freeman Keller, although many of you know me simply as Pam's daughter, which is a title that I wear proudly. On behalf of our family, I want to thank all of you for helping us remember my mom in such a meaningful way. Whether you contributed a video tribute, attended in person, or are viewing online, we truly appreciate your participation. We miss mom so incredibly much. But the outpouring of love and support that we have received from all of you has certainly helped to ease that pain. And not only have you supported us, but we know that you have also been grieving with us for this past year or so. So today, we would like to focus on how fortunate we were for the time that we had with her. We want to celebrate her life by sharing stories, memories, good company, and good food, all while enjoying some of her favorite music. Before I sign off, I want to speak briefly about how I will remember her and carry her with me going forward. And in doing so, I will focus on who my mom was at her core before ALS stole so much of her identity from her. I hope you do the same. My mom was fun. She loved music. She loved games. She loved to dance. She would always be on the lookout for concerts or shows to take us to. She was adventurous and athletic. She could swim forever. She was game for remote hiking in Glacier National Park and crazy road trips up to the Arctic Circle. And even as a 60-year-old, she decided to take on triathlons as a new hobby, because why not? One of the coolest things, though, about my mom, I think, is that she resisted being boxed into narrow, predefined categories. I want to give you a few examples of that. My mom was very forward-thinking. She valued education. She herself excelled professionally, and she strived for equality. And she did all of that, all while thoroughly enjoying sewing, cooking, caring for those around her. She had an eye for quality, but she wasn't at all materialistic. She couldn't care less how old her car was, and she preferred to mend her clothes rather than go out and buy something new. My mom was always really well put together. She was also very modest, but she flat out rejected any age limit for wearing a bikini. She was deeply committed to her friends and family, but she would never exclude others, and she took a genuine interest in meeting new people. My mom was very intelligent, but in some contexts, she could be fairly gullible and naive. That is something that my brother and my dad made sure to take full advantage of on April Fool's Day every year. I claim total innocence, but they certainly took advantage. My mom took care of herself. She cared about her health. She ate really well. She had a really balanced diet. She exercised regularly. But she also wouldn't deprive herself of enjoying things like a luxurious dessert on occasion. My mom always held herself to a higher standard no matter what was going on around her, but she wasn't judgmental or critical of others. My mom was kind and she was gentle. She was gentle with us growing up. And I think she also just had generally a gentle approach when dealing with others. And I believe that's what made her such an effective leader. But despite that gentleness, she wasn't weak. She could stand up for herself. She could stand up for others. She was an activist who would stand up for what she believed in, and she did so passionately. So in sum, my mom taught me that to have a fulfilling life, you have to truly understand your own values and then live accordingly. I was lucky enough to have a role model in her who demonstrated that for me day in and day out. And now, even though she's gone, I hold tight to these lessons and use her memory as both inspiration and motivation to do better in my own life. So, in conclusion, it is a comfort to know that many of you carry a piece of her with you as well. So thank you from the bottom of my heart for celebrating her and keeping her memory alive.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me? There's no microphone. What do you call a microphone in the hands of a preacher? A dangerous weapon. So it is good to have everyone here today. I won't be speaking especially long, but Pam, I'm one of the pastors. My Mary Beth Morgan is the other pastor at St. Mark's United Methodist Church. My name is Jimmy Moore, and Pam was the organist and pianist there, and we knew her very well. So accept this. Blessed are those who mourn. Perhaps we would translate it better. Blessed are those who celebrate with deep, life-affirming gratitude. We're here today to celebrate the life of our dear friend, Pam. We're grateful for the opportunity to do so, even at a time more distant than we had wished from the time of her death because of the COVID-19 phenomenon. We know the effects that the pandemic has had on all of us, and particularly on our rituals of mourning. But it also has given us something of a different kind of ray of light breaking through the cloud. What we do today bears an ironic witness to the long journey of grieving. For when and where that trailhead begins, it does not have a clear end point. Not after a day, or a week, or a month, or a year. If grief is the psychological terrain that feelings bring when they accompany loss, and if Kubler-Ross was right, that grief comes in stages or waves or movements, and if mourning is the collection of actions we take to process the grief, if all that is true, then we have as much need to mourn, to remember with gratitude that we did as much as we did on December 27th, 2020. Pam's gifts to us are durable, and we welcome them still into our world and into our hearts. The question comes to me at times like this, how did they do that? Often when we lose someone, I ask that question. I would love to ask that question of Pam. Now, I don't simply mean, how did she manage ALS, though that was certainly a tough row to hoe, and she did it with considerable grace. I don't either mean simply the way that she was able to work with such dignity and kindness and clarity with students and faculty and staff around some really difficult issues, or the way that she was able to lead in worship, even in meetings, gatherings like this when families were in mourning. I don't simply mean that. I want to know how she was able to do it with such extraordinary, durable kindness. Kindness may be taking a beating in the public eye, but it remains a cold drink of water for thirsty people and a poultice for a bruised community. And Pam was so very, very kind. And there were things, I do believe, many things, I'm only going to mention something, that I think undergirded her particular kindness. The 13th century Persian mystic Rumi gets at it like this. Today, like every other day, we wake up frightened and empty. Don't open the door to the study and begin reading. Take down a musical instrument. Let the beauty we love be what we do. There are hundreds of ways to kneel and kiss the ground. Let the beauty we love be what we do. I first saw that in Pam when I was doing campus ministry. I was on staff of First United Methodist Church in town and saw her working in campus, as I mentioned earlier. I saw it when she took care in worship, and especially when she would say, tell me what this family who is grieving needs. How can I play something that will be of benefit to them? Eventually, the bishop sent me on a 6-year tour of Southern Indiana, and I finally was able to come back to Bloomington and be planted here at St. Mark's, where I was fortunate enough to renew my working relationship and friendship with Pam. So over the past few weeks, I've reviewed my correspondence with her. What I realized is that whether it was a worship service or a wedding or a memorial service, Pam paid deep attention to people, to interactions, and to the promise of music, and she never, ever failed to offer gratitude. One note she wrote stands out. I had offered that I was going to be doing our worship service. I was going to be preaching the story about the woman, some of you know it, who offered a few small coins at the place of offering, and other people were offering large sums. I said, we're not going to be concentrating on the woman as much as we're going to turn the tables and turn the camera and notice the one who noticed the woman, who was not captivated by the large sums, but by this singular act of courage and generosity. And I said, we're going to use a little poem by Mary Oliver called Look and See, in which she tells the story of a sparrow who who wanted to land on a water rock, but by error landed on the back of an older duck. And she says the duck and the sparrow were both amused, but then there was that very characteristic Mary Oliver tagline, "Oh Lord, how shining and festive is your gift to us if we only look and see." Pam wrote back to me how much she loved that poem. And today, it's clear why. Pam, in her life, looked. She saw. She saw the shining, festive gift that is life, that is family, that is friendship, that is education, that is music. Pam saw this in the people that she loved, in those students whose best hopes she embraced, and she saw it in the inexplicable interplay between ebony and ivory keys on organ and piano. And we are enriched, we still are, because in her deepest heart, Pam let the beauty she loved be what she did. We are grateful for the life of this woman. Thank you.
I'm one of the lucky ones because Pam Freeman was my friend. And it's from that frame of reference that I was asked to speak today. What an honor. I know I represent scores of people, including many of you and countless others who couldn't be here today, who considered Pam in a similar light. My name is Doug Botter, known affectionately by some in this room as the other Doug in Pam's life. Probably because Pam and I lived together for 18 years, along with a group of amazing colleagues in a house just across the street from the Union on the IU campus, where Pam held court as the director of student ethics. Pam was actually my boss during that time. But from the moment I was interviewed for the job as coordinator of the GLB office, as it was known in 1984, and escorted by Pam around 705 East 7th Street, shown a storage room that would eventually become my office, I remember thinking as I envisioned the possibility of working with her that I hoped before long I might be considered not just a colleague of Pam's, but as something more. And that didn't take long. As we started planning together, working on issues of harassment and discrimination on campus and in the community, as we decided who would respond to calls from the press about this issue or that, and about how I might enhance her important work with the incident teams and the Commission on Multicultural Understanding, we began comparing notes about other aspects of our lives, sharing stories about our families, the successes of our children, stories about our spouses, including ones about the real Doug, vacations, and such. I was honored to participate in significant moments in the Freeman family, and because of Pam's generous spirit and amazing talents as a musician, she became the darling of a group of mostly gay men who were organizing a chorus in town, who you'll hear from in just a moment or two. On the occasion of her retirement, I remember referring to Pam as the conscience of Indiana University, not only because she called students to the highest ethical standards, but because she also challenged faculty members and administrators to do the same. And while she was uncompromising and seeking the best from others, she always did so with a kind and gentle spirit. Soon after her diagnosis with ALS, a group of us organized a reception for Pam, which included the presentation of a book of memories to her, letters from former colleagues and students, deans and faculty members, and people from the larger community who had been impacted by her work. And what struck me in reading through that book recently was how many of those letters referred to Pam as a friend. Allow me to share a portion of four of those letters with you. This from her doctoral dissertation advisor. Pam Freeman was one of my best doctoral advisees at the University of Tennessee. At about the time she was to begin the dissertation phase of her program, she told me she was expecting her first child. Apparently, she feared I would doubt her determination to finish. I did not doubt her. More than once during the planning phase, she brought the baby, who played on a blanket on the floor of my office while she worked on her planned research. That child caused little delay in her graduation. Was that you? It was your brother. That was Ross. Good for you, Ross. This from a former student. Dear Pam, when we met, I knew next to nothing about student affairs, student conduct, or bias response. Through your mentorship, I have found myself in a career I never thought possible. And what better mentor could I possibly have had? Each day, even on the hardest days, you modeled professionalism, kindness, compassion, humor, an appreciation for research and evidence, and respect for the dignity of all. I think about you often. When I am struggling with a difficult decision, I can always return to something you said to me or a situation we reasoned through, and then recalibrate my moral compass. From you, I learned that politics, publicity, and potential lawsuits be damned. The right thing to do is always the best thing to do. There is no more important lesson than that, your friend. And from a colleague here at IU, dear Pam Freeman, I'm so proud to know you. You have been a very supportive and kind colleague over the years. You wear your beautiful heart on your sleeves and your warm expression no matter what the issue may involve. You seem to always take a quietly humble and respectful approach to individuals and situations. You are one of IU's brightest and best points of light that brings joy to a Big Ten university that is in continuous change each and every day. However, your passionate and caring heart remains humble and kind. Life takes us on a journey with many surprises, and one of the greatest presents is having a colleague, a friend, that is steadfast and supportive. And lastly, a member of the larger community writes, I am so grateful, Pam, to have experienced the gift of making music with you. Thank you for sharing your talent as our accompanist extraordinaire for many performances over the years. Your musical direction in piano and organ playing lifted us higher as musicians and brought us closer as friends. I am so grateful to have you in my life. A few days before my own retirement from IU in December of 2019, I was cleaning out my office and remembered that I had a prayer discreetly affixed to the back door of the backside of the door to the entrance of my office. I didn't want to offend anyone whose experience with religion as a queer person had brought nothing but pain into their lives, so that prayer was only visible when I closed the door to the office, which was seldom. Still, I wanted to remind myself why I was doing what I was doing. The prayer was written by Sister Ruth Marlene Fox in 1985, and I thought of it as a kind of benediction of the work all of us did in 705 East 7th Street. It reads, May God bless you with discomfort at easy answers, half-truths, and superficial relationships, so that you may live deep within your heart. May God bless you with anger at injustice, oppression, and exploitation of people, so that you may work for justice, freedom, and peace. May God bless you with tears to shed for those who suffer pain and rejection, so that you may reach out your hand to comfort them and turn their pain into joy. And may God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you can make a difference in the world, so that you can do what others claim cannot be done. As I removed that prayer from the back of my office door, I thought of Pam, who had walked me through that old house, wonderful old house, 25 years before. Pam, who loved deeply within her heart. Pam, who worked for justice and freedom and peace. Pam, who on more than one occasion turned people's pain into joy, and who often did what others claimed could not be done. I will always be grateful for the life of Pam Freeman, for the opportunity that was mine to work with her, and for the fact that I was able to call her my friend.
Son-in-law. And I think the reason why I make a good spokesman for the family in discussing Pam is because I am a great example of Pam's inclusivity. I edited these videos, and as I was editing them, that term just kept coming up over and over again. It's something that many of you said very specifically about her. And to kind of explain a little bit about that inclusivity, I need to tell you a little bit about myself. My parents got divorced when I was 6 years old. I haven't seen my mother since I was 8. Don't really have a relationship with my father, and I'm an only child. My grandparents are gone, don't have much of a nuclear family, or however you want to put it. And when I met Lynn, I was in a phase of failing out from IU. Lots of things were going south, and you know, I met this amazing woman, started dating her, but inside I was terrified that the Associate Dean of Students was going to pull out her magnifying glass and look at my transcripts. And that never happened, never. She accepted me from the start. And from that summer through the next year while my wife was finishing up at Purdue, family Christmases, every single part of their family from that point forward, I was immediately a part of. And I think she's that way with a lot of people. I think there's a lot of people in this room that probably feel very similar about that. And so when my wife and I moved to California for her to go to graduate school, Pam and Doug moved us out there. They paid for Lynn's half and a lot of my part. And, you know, as I was trying to get a job out there and kind of working my way through, trying to rehabilitate myself so I could finish college as well. They paid for Lynn's graduation trip, which we took to San Francisco and helped move us back to Bloomington. And when it came time to get back into IU, after I had rehabilitated my grades and done some work, Pam was an ally of mine, and she helped support me. You know, and obviously this building and the church right there, so much of it, I feel connected to her. And I think it was a couple halls down that she stood in there on my support. And so through all these different phases of getting closer to their daughter and becoming a part of family, she was there 100%. And it was hard for me because I had trouble with trust issues. As I told you guys, my background, my father would remarry or date someone, or different people come into the world, and they would try to be this mother role, and it was just not a natural fit. And I would reject those people often, for good reason in some cases. When I was 20 years old, I think I counted once that I'd moved 40 times. So you can understand why I was a little apprehensive about some of this stuff. And it took a while for me to really accept her as a mother figure, even though she absolutely deserved it from the first day. And it wasn't until later in her life when I started being more honest with her and really made myself vulnerable to her that I really was able to finish that kind of a connection to her. And once again, it was because she didn't look at my transcripts, or maybe she did and just never told me. I think that's probably the case. But it's because of all those things she did that led up to that, that allowed me to develop this level of trust with her. And finally I would tell her if something would go poorly or I needed to get advice or something that I wasn't comfortable talking about, wasn't the best thing to discuss, I'd discuss it with her anyway. And it took time for that to happen. And as she got ALS and her disease worsened, the I love you started coming out a lot more. And it took a long time to get there, but it did. And I've said this a couple times to people. This is probably the most nervous I've ever been in a public setting. I've spoken in front of other type of group settings, but I was really thinking about why Like, what's the reason? Why am I so nervous? And I realized it's because of how much I care about her and how much I knew everyone in this room would also care about her. And then today, I had an epiphany, and it was, Pam wouldn't want me to go through that. She wants us all to be here for joy. She's here, you know, she wanted us all to be happy and the positive stuff. And it's because of all that goodness that we feel the sadness. And I think that's really what it all boils down to. I think Pam was, she became family to me. I think she became family to a lot of you. And I can spend the rest of the next 45 minutes talking about the family and how much everyone means to me. The direct family, the aunts, the uncles, the friends, all the people I've met, you know, through her. And I just think she went from, I went from being someone who didn't have a family to now someone who has a family. And I miss her very much, just as much as every one of you guys. Thank you.
It's so wonderful being here. As many of you have already said, Pam was very close to many of us individually and certainly to us as a whole chorus. She was our accompanist for many years. But more than that, she was a part of our lives. And she certainly left each of us, I think, a better person. One of the pieces that the chorus commissioned while she was our accompanist was a piece with the title of Will and Testament. And I just want to read you a couple of words from that text so that you get the feeling of the meaning for it. The words are, I will leave a legacy of beauty and color and vitality. I will leave looking and loving and letting go, like the sound of summer's end. I will leave a legacy of life. And I believe that that's what Pam has left us, is a legacy of life. Thank you also to the family for inviting us.
Thank you. Before we conclude the formal portion of our celebration today, I wanted to just say a brief note of thanks to all of you. I want to start with Jimmy and Doug and Sean. They were in the hot seat, and I want to thank them first. Mom had a special connection with each of you, and we are so appreciative that you were all three able to come and speak a few words about her. And, well, not that Sean had much of a choice in the matter, but we appreciate you all very much. Thank you. Mom would never forgive me if I didn't especially acknowledge the musicians. And so to Barry and Connie, the Coryland Men's Chorus, the chorus was a source of endless support and camaraderie, amazing music. My mom just felt at home when she was with you. And so the fact that you were able to be here today and give us the gift of that beautiful piece in her honor is just so, so meaningful to us. Thank you. To Aunt Sharon, wherever she is, she's probably hiding. I knew it. She was hiding in the back. She opened up today the celebration by playing Claire de Lune on the piano. And Claire de Lune has particular significance to our family, and I know that my mom and Aunt Sharon shared a special bond over that piece as well. And I have to say, it cannot have been easy to play at her own sister's memorial. So the fact that she was able to do so with such grace and skill, I admire her already, but even more so now. Thank you so much, Aunt Sharon. To Julian. Julian is our most amazing pianist here. We gave him the task of playing everything from Bach to Carole King today, and his skill and his talent and his expertise we're so appreciative of you. Thank you so much for being here, Julian. Now, to all of you, I honestly had no idea how many people would show up today. We have this long delay since she passed. I probably should have gotten a bigger room had I known that there was going to be such a wonderful turnout today. From the bottom of my heart, thank you so much for being here, for keeping her memory alive, keeping a part of her with you going forward. On behalf of my family, thank you so very, very much for being here. So now, I invite all of you to mingle, gather together. Mom appreciated connecting with people more than anything else, and so please, let's spend the rest of the time catching up with old friends. Please enjoy the refreshments in the back. Visit the various reflection stations, as we've been calling them. We've set up various mementos around the room. And with my deepest thanks, please, I invite you to go and mingle now. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Music has been a critical part of my life since I was a child. And I think the main reason it's so critical in my life is that it helps me keep my emotions in balance. It is a way to relax. It's sheer enjoyment for me. And I really, really hope that people will understand the value of music, not just for having a job, but for people to be able to appreciate aesthetics and appreciate and see the world in a different way than if they don't have the arts in their life. The way that you see all sorts of societal issues differs if you can think in terms of the arts. It helps us be critical thinkers. It helps us think broadly. And I hope that the value of music will not be lost because money is tight. I just don't think you can put a price on it. It's just invaluable.
Hi, Lynn and Ross and Doug and all of your families. I just want to say how much I loved working with your mother. I worked with Pam for 7 years at the Office of Student Ethics, and I was always inspired by her, the way she started the incidence teams, her very even-handed approach to students who were sometimes in trouble and students who often needed support. She was just always there. I think she made a massive difference at the university. She was on the vanguard for the Big Ten as far as working on these programs that were about social justice and social change. And it was incredibly inspiring to work with her. It was also a privilege. I had the good fortune to also be her friend, and I met her at Montessori when all of you were young, and then later when she was accompanying for Quarryland, I played duets with her and performed with her even at St. Mark's. So I felt we had a shared background that was about music and about art and also about a passion for being fair and kind to the people you come in contact with. Pam was amazing. We so miss her. She was remarkable, and we'll all always keep that in our memories.
Hi, my name is Char, and I'd like to share some memories that I have of Pam. Pam was a neighbor first. We met at her new house that they moved into on Sussex. I remember knocking on the front door, and she was making a turkey of all things. And Lynn was in a little pumpkin swinging seat, and Ross was about 3 years old. And that was our first meeting. From there, our friendship grew because our children were about the same age, and they went to the same school, Childs Elementary School, and they did activities together at the YMCA. And with all the children together, we ran into each other a lot. Pam and I trained for multiple 5K runs at the YMCA along with our children. We also shared a love of puzzles, and I remember going to Pam's house, and we shared a love of folk music and often would listen to Joni Mitchell, Simon and Garfunkel, and Irish music. We loved Irish music. And we would have some tea and cookies and do our puzzle. And that was just heavenly. Another thing we would often do as families, we would go to their pontoon boat on Lake Monroe. And Pam would always bring enough food. It didn't matter how many people were on that boat, she always had enough food. And one of the things that all of us loved were her deviled eggs. She always made deviled eggs. whatever event we were going to. Also, we did kayaking and canoeing on Sugar Creek with a group of friends. We'd always stop for lunch, and again, those deviled eggs would come out and they'd be devoured quickly. But I think one of the things that brought our families close was with another family, the Smith family. We had the Freeman, Smith, and Wozniak co-ops, what we called. And every Saturday, one family would have all the kids, and the one, and then the other two adults could go out for dinner if they want, or whatever they wanted to do that Saturday night. And we would trade Saturdays like that. And I think through that, our kids became very good friends, almost like cousins. Actually, I think we became each other's Bloomington family. Every year, also, we eagerly would go to Brown County at a cabin. We'd meet at a cabin at Christmas time. We all shared, it was the Smiths, the Freemans, and the Wozniaks. We would share food and puzzles again. We would do hikes together, play games. There was always lots of laughter during those times and reflection time as a family. It was a traditional event that even when our children grew up and left Bloomington and had their own lives and children elsewhere, they still tried to come back to the cabin. That always felt like Bloomington family. Early on, I remember Linda, Pam, and I would meet at the corner of Queensway, and early morning runs we did. This was before our children got up and were awakened to get ready for school. We used to do these runs. It was just easy to talk to Pam. It felt good when we were together. I will always cherish the memories that I have and keep them in my heart. Love you, Pam.
Pam is one of the kindest, most hardworking people I've ever met. I first met her back in 1996 when I was a freshman at IU. She was my phase mentor, and she became my mentor overall. She introduced me to so many people. She got me a job. She helped me grow so much. She took me under her wing despite how busy she was. She was always there for me in my 4 years as an undergrad, and she continued to be there for me as I went out into the world. I'm so grateful to have known you, Pam. Thank you so much. I appreciate you. I love you, and I'll miss you. Thanks.
Hey, everybody. My name's Leah Jansen. I grew up across the street from the Freemans, and I was childhood and current best friend to Lynn Freeman Keller. And I have gotten to know Pam through basically my whole life since I was three. And she was always so kind and compassionate and graceful and funny and involved. And she was an advocate and an activist. And she wore so many hats. And one thing that really sticks with me is she was always so inclusive of me and included me on all the like summer camps and the sports events and the dance classes. And I sat next to Lynn as she learned the piano, and I just watched in awe because there was no way I was going to do that. And so I just have a profound gratitude for Pam and just the love and kindness that she instilled in her family. And she will be missed. I have trouble describing all of that, but I will miss her as like a second mom, that's for sure. And from time to time get to hear her a little bit in Lynn's laugh. And I don't know if I've told her that, but sometimes when I hear her laugh, I can hear Pam, and it's this like beautiful little joy and light that I get to hear just a little sparkle of. And I'm grateful for Lynn and Sean and Max and their family and Doug and Ross and everybody for truly being a second family to me. So yeah, I just wanted to share that moment, and I love you all.
Hello, everyone. My name is Oyibo Afoako. I'm very grateful for the opportunity to make a couple of comments about my dear friend, mentor, Dr. Pam Freeman. When I first came to IU in 2002 to serve as the inaugural director of the new Marshall Black Cultural Center, Pam was one of the first few individuals or friends or colleagues to reach out to me. We became friends almost immediately. I was always looking up to her. She was very fair. She was very supportive of everyone, students and colleagues and families and everybody. She served on my advisory board. She and I also were members of the Commission on Multicultural Understanding, COMU. Pam was not only a mentor, she supported me when I was a doctoral student. I served as an intern and shadowed her for some weeks when I was doing my doctoral program in student affairs. I learned so much about managing, how to manage relationships with students and parents and families and friends. It was a very good experience, and she enriched my doctoral internship experience so much. When I was doing my doctoral research, my dissertation, she also was one of the editors. She read my doctoral dissertation and gave constructive feedback and suggestions. Pam, my family and I love you so much. We know you are in good hands with the Lord, and you are going to be greatly missed. We have missed you so much already. We love you so much. Thank you.
Hi, this is Margie Hershey. I was Lynn's Girl Scout leader for a very long time, from her kindergarten year until she graduated from high school. And that's how I got to know Pam. Pam was one of the blessed people who went camping with our Girl Scout troop. It wasn't exactly camping, but nevertheless, it was something that neither Pam nor I was exactly accustomed to. And I vividly remember the one thing that Pam would do when we first got to the cabins was to make sure that somebody had brought the coffee. And invariably, three other people had decided that they would do the same thing. Pam was a wonderful leader. She was so principled, so highly principled, and yet also such a caring and loving person, so that she didn't hold those strong principles over anybody's head. She helped people achieve them. And that was a wonderful thing for Indiana University. It was a wonderful thing for Pam's friends and for her family. And I think that she added so much to the sense of justice, of fair play, of treating others as you would have them treat you. The kinds of principles that we all talk about and rarely put into practice. Pam always did. She lived her life that way. I'm very grateful to have been her friend and to know that she'll never be away from me or from her family. She'll always be with us because her voice will always be with us.
We're Deb and Pete Klusterman. We have lots of wonderful memories about Pam. Deb's going to share a few of those.
So we met Pam and Doug at a dinner group that we were invited to join. And at that dinner group, we found out that we'd both rented the same house on Tudor Lane when we first moved here. And the Freemans had rented it the year before us. Further conversation led to discovering that we both like canoeing, and an over 30-year tradition started with a yearly canoe trip down Sugar Creek. I still can see Pam floating down Sugar Creek, enjoying cool weather or cool water on a hot day, and even a day that was not too warm. She also packed wonderful lunches and treats, homemade cookies, deviled eggs, sandwiches. I had to step up my game. We also had some wonderful and memorable dinners that Pam planned, both in their home and on the boat. I still use many of the recipes she shared. She will be missed.
She will be missed.
My name is Alice Denise Kling. I am the second youngest cousin on the Werner side. My mom, Catherine, was the middle child between her brothers, DeLynn and Uncle Clark. Clark was quite a character and the dad of four lovely girls, my cousins. So, Pam of which was the second oldest. And so one of the table legs of the supports of my life and one of the always and forever people. It's hard to imagine a world without her energy, and I remember her sewing adventures when she was younger, always music in the house. And because I grew up far from Indiana in Maine, it was an amazing event to return home to Indiana and to catch a little piece of the culture of that household. I'm forever grateful for the beacon of light that was Cousin Pam. And I'm standing in front of a picture of our grandfather when he was young and played tennis. So I send lots of love and just the depths of loss for so many of us. And lots of hugs for people back home. Bye.
Hey, this is Cub Jansen. Memories of Pam Freeman. She was a great person. It's hard to believe she's not here. Pam was always there when you wanted to talk. We were neighbors for several years. We just helped each other out in just so many different ways. We would get together with Pam and Doug and Gare and I and do puzzles into the wee hours of the morning, drinking wine, of course. We'd never seem to finish that puzzle because Doug would always steal the last piece. So, just really good memories of Pam.
You do.
Or maybe
Trisha
looks
so
beautiful.
Greetings, family and friends of Pam Freeman. This is our tribute in loving memory of Pam from Dave and Susan Jones. Pam was a very special person in so many ways to Susan and me, and to everyone who knew her. We'd like to share some of our thoughts in the form of some pictures, some photographs, and our comments on them. We have been close to Pam and Doug for perhaps 40 years as members of a marvelous dinner group. Most years, we had one of our dinners afloat on Lake Monroe. The first picture shows Pam and Doug and our late friend Marty Yoakum in one such happy time on two of our boats. The next picture shows some of us in the water in between dinner courses. Not a great picture, but if you look closely, you will see distant dots in the water that represent the ambitious swimmers among us. The most distant of these swimmers? Undoubtedly it was Pam. She was always the healthiest, most athletic one of us. Only the most cynical disease could slow her down. Now please see the next picture from the Bloomington Herald Times newspaper from 29 years ago tomorrow, April 4th, 1993. It commemorated the sad 25th anniversary of the passing of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in 1968. The names, the signatures of 4,000 area residents are included in this tribute to a great American. The following picture is a close-up of the upper left corner of this newspaper page. Note the very first name. Pam was always at the head of the line in support of others. One last picture for you to view. At one of our last dinner group gatherings, when Pam's illness was already taking hold, she presented each of us with a planter filled with seasonal blooms, beautiful ones. We keep our planter refreshed and will treasure it in Pam's memory always. Pam was kind and generous, strong and wise, always looking out for others. Her social consciousness was a model for all of us. She also appreciated and shared beauty in this world and would have us all take the time to do the same. In all these ways, Pam is still with us and always will be. Let me close by thanking Doug and Ross and Lynn with sharing this wonderful person with us.
I could sing Pam's praises for hours, but I think I'll sum it up by just talking about the fact that we always had this joke that I wanted to be her when I grew up. And that is still true to this day. I haven't achieved that yet, but whether it was the way she just commanded a room in her role as the associate dean and how she had the respect of everyone at IU and just handled such a hard job in student ethics with such grace. Or if she was tearing up the dance floor, doing Zumba with us, dancing at conferences, the way she could just drive a boat and eat a Big Mac with gusto. She was just so much fun and so graceful and loving and giving and generous and wise in everything she did. We didn't always agree and on everything, but I always knew that if she was making a decision, it was done with heart and honesty and compassion. And I just have always admired her so much, and I feel so lucky to have spent so many days next to her, learning from her and being her friend. I will miss her forever, and I send love to all of you.
Pam Freeman, what a wonderful life lived and an incredible inspiration to so many people. I feel lucky to have known her practically my whole life. Pam was more than just a family friend. She was a second mom to me. From spending countless hours together between ballet and soccer and basketball and many trips to the Outer Banks, Pam always treated me like another daughter. Growing up, she always had great stories and advice for us, and she continued to pass on her wisdom as she supported us getting married and having children of our own. I have always admired Pam in so many ways, but since becoming a mom, I realized how truly special she was. I will never know how she managed to be everything to everyone at home and at work. What an incredible role model she was. I know she would take great pride in watching Lynn follow in her footsteps. There was never a dull moment with Pam around. She brought smiles and laughter to the room with ease. I will always miss and cherish the many hours spent around the table, enjoying each other's company and savoring the incredible home-cooked meals she was always able to present. I love you, Pam, so much. The memories we all have of times shared with you will never be forgotten.
Hi, I'm Linda Smith. I first met Pam in 1984. She was a long, tall, blonde, full of games and fun and ambition and kindness, and we became the best of friends for almost 40 years. We shared raising our children, cooking gourmet dinners, swimming at Lake Monroe, camping, exercising at the Y at 6 a.m. in the morning for over 30 years. We shared puzzles. We shared, in fact, she taught me the transition from saying gingerbread man to saying gingerbread person. We shared all the joys and all the sorrows of lives fully lived. And I miss her deeply.
Thank you.
May God's blessing keep you always. May your wishes all come true. May you always do for others and let others do for you. May you build a ladder to the stars and climb on every rung. May you stay. May you grow up to be true. May you always know the truth and see the light surrounding you. May you always be courageous, stand upright and be strong, and may you stay. door. You just pull out my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come running, running, yeah, yeah, to see you again.
Oh, when darkness comes. Sail on, silver girl. Sail.